Just hit the ground running. So at this time, I want to recognize the committee that helped me create this, and if you will stand as I call your name so we can recognize you. Julie George.
I am wearing, by the way, the scarf. The scarf that went to Paris. The scarf that went to Paris followed the curve of the Seine, through heavy monuments of stone, grandiose and lofty bridges, past the elegant modern Louvre, her favorite, Musée d'Orsay, to Saint-Chapelle and Notre-Dame, to outdoor cafes and street vendors of Crêpe and Pomfret. This is my journey, the brown shimmering strands, a gift from my long-gone friend, my raison d'etat for writing in this moment, her memory a painting, a moving river. I settle on the shaded bank, brown scarf rising on the wind.
Suzanne glanced down and thought of his folly. John had asked her for her hand on that spring day, her heart now filled with deep melancholy. He went gambling and was taken away. John gambled that night and won a large sum in a plush hall that reeked of snobbery, then left with whore Jill, who begged him to come and knifed him to complete the robbery. Suzanne's hands trembled handling the teacup. No better she fared with a biscuit plate, too upset to sleep, too tired to sup. Had it been random, or was it just fate? It's hard for the English to give up tea, but her cup's now full of good Scotch whiskey.
Often taken with a nervous stomach, like a bootlegger in a raid. They never bothered to look for a quiet corner to lean into. Instead, they chose a table blanched in sunlight in the hub of bustle brought on by the hustle of lunch hour full of the clink of silver on dishes, stationed as close to the door as a mobster's right-hand man clings to his master's side.
Color draws me closer, the red of her hat finding a compliment in his tie, bulbous blue urn, elliptical green leaves, burnished brass, rich brown of door, and on the slender, shapely form of the waitress, gray as soft as the underbelly of a spinel. Arrested in this New York restaurant moment, my eye travels over the fluidity of shapes, curved chair backs, casual drape of shrugged-off coat, silhouette of standing diner, waitress bending over a table. The waitress, will she straighten up with her tray, move swiftly off toward the kitchen? I ache for her to move, yet see that she must hold steady, let the glint of sun on apron ally with tablecloth to cameo two diners. She leaning off to the side a bit pensively, and he, it seems clearer now, simply eating lunch.
Lumber. Three tall men who answered the call, Uncle Sam wants you. Men proud in fine new military coats and hats, enlisted to serve their country, the only one they knew. A land so recently healed of war, and yet they returned to war. The point driven home, nails pounded so hard, the hammer marks impressed into the boards. Three men, their images like the imprints of ghosts who had passed through. Black men whose eyes wax innocent, patient, not knowing what comes next for them. The eyes see, but the voices cannot speak, for they have not yet permission. Having their motives, conscientiousness questioned, criticized, one reverent in his commitment with his cattle. The seated man bearing the brunt of it all, targeted by enemy and enemy alone.
Tea time. She unfortunately could not be with us this evening. So Pam Carney, one of the committee members and a fellow docent at the museum here, is going to read the poem in her place.
Tea for two. You are stepping through the archway of my studio, pushing past the thick red drape that I've tucked aside so that the sunlight could run its natural course window to window. You stand, waiting for me to clear some place to set the tea things. I know, the wooden floor has pools of unread letters, empty picture frames sprawled against the wall, and there are still 1,000 paintings that must be completed before the rooms darken. You are surprisingly not critical about it all today. You do not even stand behind my easel and point out what is left to do, what colors I've wronged, and how I should make amends. You're already late for the wedding. An old acquaintance, perhaps? A cousin? I confess I wasn't listening. All I know is you don't care for who it is, and have decided to wear white so as to offend the bride who will scorn your simple gown and the very dull way you have coiled your mahogany hair. But then you come into the studio bearing tea in that glorious cape you begged me to buy you. 2 whole landscapes worth of a cape. And I confess its rain cloud blue is bewitching, how it enfolds you like a tulip, its exquisite pink lining peddling around your collarbone. No one will dare say we are poor artists now. You with your silent music, me with my glistening paints.
In second place is Hannah Forner, and her piece is Between There and Here, inspired by New York Restaurant.
Hi, my name is Hannah Forner, and I'm also a student of Mary Tyler's. My poem is called Between There and Here. Heaven is not so paintable as a New York restaurant in 1922. Humming smooth symphonic jazz and steaming with cups of hot Earl Grey and chamomile tea. The white tablecloth sparsely speckled with the crumbs of toasted croissants and mini eclairs, while outside of the frosted glass windows, the world flutters back and forth between loneliness and fruitfulness. Hopper, I think I know a thing or two about the raw disorder of separation. Like oil separating from the pigments of paint, like the space inside the empty eyes of men, or like the merciless feeling of a woman with her back turned.
All right. And last but not least is Charlotte Wilmer. And I know Patricia Clark is here. Patricia and I have actually worked on quite a few projects together, so she just wanted to say a few things about the collaboration and things that we've done together.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I think it's really wonderful to have the various universities around here collaborate with the museum, and really this exercise of looking at a piece of art is really done around the world as a wonderful way to train a poet's eye to look at detail. And then what happens often is you you look at the detail and you lose yourself in the painting and you start to say some amazing things. And you can hear in all the poems that we've heard kind of questions and interrogations and interesting speculations about the art. And it's just really, really fun. So I encouraged my writing class at Grand Valley to look at the images, to come down and look at them in person, which of course is better than just looking at them online if they could. And I don't know how many students entered, but I was really delighted when Charlotte told me, I guess, or did I hear from you, Alan, that that she had won. And Charlotte isn't even a writing major. What's your major, Charlotte?
Math.
She's got a very wry sense of humor, too. So I think this is the third class that she's taken from me, but I was just really, I loved her poem before she entered it, and I was hopeful that she would place. But to have her win first prize, I'm just really proud of her. So thanks, and I might take a picture of her when she's up here.
Don't worry, Charlotte. I was an art history major and a math minor, so you can combine the two. So Charlotte Wilmore, and her piece is based on the At Home and Abroad by Wycliffe Lovell, and Where the Children Will Go. So come on up, Charlotte.
Hi, my name's Charlotte, and my title of my poem is Where the Children Will Go. Stand with a straight back. The future is no place for slouching boys. Be serious now, with your brothers by your side, and your button coats to warm you from what you will endure away from this home I've made for you. Away from this house, I don't know where you'll travel, and it's possible that when you return, you'll be broken and bloody, sleeping in a wooden box. But perhaps you'll get letters that talk about coins weighing in your pockets, and graceful girls who have held your working hands. At my table, I can feed you cornbread and ham soaked in brown sugar gravy, but out there, I don't know what will silence your howling stomachs. The world is no place for a tender boy. You'll travel aboard iron ships and tin trains, and the world will creep behind you with quivering arrows in its bow, ready to pierce your open hearts.
Participate. And also, as I said this evening, the galleries are open until 8 o'clock, and we will have a few docents on hand, so if you have any questions about some of the works of art, they're there. There are many treats, so please help yourself, or else the staff has to eat them. And there's coffee. We did fix a coffee pot, but we put it in a coffee urn. So, so thank you for coming in again. A big round of applause for all those. Thank you.
Bye.